I'm in jet lag. For me, it's early in the morning. Okay, my name is Krunoslav Mihalic. I'm Microsoft PFE, platform Microsoft PFE from Europe. If you know Europe a little bit better, then it's Serbia. And I cover Central Eastern Europe. So, let's do some expectation settings. And please leave the door open, because it's going to be a little bit uncomfortable after 1 hour because ventilation is not so good here. Okay, setting expectations. Now, if you believe that you will learn anything useful on this session for everyday work, you are in the wrong room. It's even worse. If you try to repeat some of those demos, you might end up losing your job, contract, getting divorced, whatever, okay? And losing a lot of money. So, this is useful for your everyday work, like watching the Top Gear to buy the car. It's a fun. Some things are useful, so let's start. If you agree on all this, please stay. If not, you can stay. We don't care. So, let's start. Let's do the PowerPoint, okay? This is one slide. This is second slide. Third slide. Fourth slide. Fifth. Gone. That's the PowerPoint, okay? So let's start. I have 5 demos. Now, I have a 75-minute session. So if I do the 5 demos, it will take me 25 minutes. So it's a little bit of the story. If you, there are characters in this story which are completely, let's put it this way, fictional. If somebody recognized himself in that story, like my colleague in front row, it's, don't bother. So let's start with first demo. Now, you need to understand, I'm presenting the PowerShell from 2006. When it was not even RTM, okay? And in those days, when you come to because I meet a lot of customers, when I go to see customers, says, do you want me to help you script something? So, no. Today, it's a little bit better, but this presentation is meant to show how easy it is to script with PowerShell, okay? So the first demo is called business case, okay? I don't know about you, but I like business case. Usually how it goes. Hello, my manager. Can I get a new laptop? Do you have a business case? Can you buy me a Ferrari? Sure, give me a business case. I will buy you a Ferrari. Now, I like business case as Kung Fu Panda likes stairs, okay? If you watch that movie, you know what I'm talking about, okay? Now, I was trying to convince one of my customers to script something, to learn PowerShell, to do something useful, to automate stuff. And he was, no. And after some time, he says, okay, I'll give you a chance. If you convince my boss to buy me 40-inch LCD, if you build a business case using PowerShell to buy me 40-inch LCD, I will say the PowerShell is cool. Right. So I say, okay, why do you need 40-inch LCD TV? He says, I would like to monitor the service. I want to have LCD with all the data from all my servers. When I see this LCD, I know that all servers are running well. So let's try. I have 3 machines, DC, file setter, and workstation. So this is the workstation. Now, how do you get the performance data in PowerShell? Oh, not WMI. Get counter, right? You can use WMI, but it's get counter, okay? You type get counter. -- computer name. This is 01. And you get some data. Easy, right? You can even build a script. I believe I have one. Get OSinfo, server, this is Irun. So, here it goes. You have a server, you have processor, you have memory, and a little bit on the right, you have disk. Now, if I do something like this, if I didn't make any typo, it will hit the two servers, you will get the processor data. Now, if you put this on the screen, not very nice. We like GUI, right? We like to be nice gadget that works. How hard is to connect PowerShell and gadgets? There is one component, actually it's third party, you need to buy it. It's called PowerGadget. I'm really sorry because they are not developing it anymore, but it's really cool. Let me show you what it does. It takes a little bit time to start. So let me see where it is. Minute or two, it will start. So this is the gadget. By default, it shows the value of 50. If I send any other value, it will show the value that I'm sending to it. So what is my idea? Would it be nice to have all those counters on one desktop? But it's even better. This one doesn't look very good. So we're going to do a little bit of customization. So if you like cars, it's West Coast, or we are on the East Coast, right? So let's try something like this. Any measures here? Come on. One. Hands up. Two, three. Now this is test for you. If majority of measures say this is a business case to put LCD on the wall, follow me. So if you do it, because you have an editor for this gadget, so you can do something like this. It takes a little bit, but it's worth waiting, trust me. Wow. You see? On the left, it's memory. On the right is processor. In the middle is a disk. And you just populate those things on. And you see, it's moving, because what it does, every 5 seconds, it will call this script, and it will get the data. So what you can do, you can, for some reason, resolution is a bit low than I was expecting, but let's see. I'm going to pass two more. And what you do, you put this one here, and you put third one. I mean, what's better? The higher resolution, the more of those things you can put on the TV. So for anyone for 4Ks, LCDs, right? Perfect. And you know what is even better? Because I bet you that you can force your managers to buy you two screens. One, he will put in his room so he can see this one, okay? And other, you can put in your. You know, it's even better. You don't even need to show him real data because you're actually filtering the stuff. Now, let's see how it goes. Any managers, is this business case to put LCD on the wall or not? No. This is, you see? This is why I don't have a Ferrari, right? Now, this is actually a real story. They actually put the monitor that they were really happy. This one cost about $100 if you want to buy third party, but but they're actually not developed anymore. So after some times, the same customer, because right now he is having his 40-inch TV, and he asked me, okay, it works, I get PowerShell. Now, can you come to me and help me get the data from remote machine? What OS do you have? 2012, perfect. Right, we're going to do it. Easy. How can we do it? I need to get the data from remote machine. I need to start the program or I need to read something. Remoting, right? I went there, and what happened is that, okay, that machine is on Hyper-V. Perfect. But there is one small issue. Not worth mentioning it. We don't have network connectivity to that machine. So what? How do you mean? Oh, it's in different subnet. I would like to connect from my machine. How do you mean you don't have a network connectivity? No, you mean firewall? No. It's completely different. You can go to the Hyper-V host, but not to VM itself. Right. So let me show you something. Now, because this is, can you see it? Now, how many network cards do I have here? Zero, right? So it's not just that there is no network connectivity, there are no network cards here. So what I'm going to try, to start the program from, this is a Hyper-V host, this is virtual machine Hyper-V host. I'm going to try to start the program on this virtual machine, which I cannot connect to it in any other way. How hard can it be done? So let's try. I have a special function called execute command. So this is my Hyper-V host. Okay. It takes a couple of parameters called execute command. Virtual machine host location, it's local host. Virtual machine name, this is name of the virtual machine, and command. So, let's see. Notepad? Is that okay for you? This is a task manager. Now it's a little bit, do you see the notepad here? No, let's scroll down there. Any notepads? No. So let's try. I have a prompt. Anything else? Can I execute PowerShell command on the remote machine? For example, get Windows feature? Let's try. For example, DNS. Ooh, I even get the prompt back. It's like I did it on machine itself. Can install something. Let's install DNS. So let me show you. I'm not cheating here. Add roles and features. Next. DNS is not installed. Here it is, okay? It will take a little bit. Now, before you start thinking that you see dead people looking at that screen, the trick is here, what I'm doing is that only way that I can do is that I can write in the registry of that virtual machine from the host. Do you know what is KVP, key value pair exchange? No. In Hyper-V, you have ability to write to the registry of the virtual machine. You can read information from the registry. It's a special part of the registry. This is how can we, for example, get IP address, host name, everything else. So what I'm doing is that I'm actually sending the command on that registry, and on the host machine, I have workflow, which in background reads that that string, runs invoke expression, and returns the data back and read the data. So what we did with this demo, but this is not just a demo, this is real-time example, because we manage to, for example, control machine which are in DMZ, which we cannot get anyway. And basically, when I ran this on internal Microsoft conference a couple of years ago, and some of the people from product group picked that up and used it for different kind of things. So let me show you how it works. So let's go to this machine and try add Windows feature. So I have DNS installed. I have just installed DNS remotely on a machine that does not have any network card. Can I make it the domain controller? Install, add Windows feature, ADDS, and then install ADDS first. One command. It's not really anything special. I have here, what I'm doing here is that I'm writing to the registry. Now it's a little bit, font is not very good, but there is a command, and all other entries that you see are actually text that I'm reading back. So you can actually control machine remotely without having any connectivity to it. You just need to be a little bit creative. And I use this a lot. This is actually something that I use a lot. Now, what else I can demo to you? I have that same customer asked me, can I do, for example, deployment of virtual machines? Okay, so sure, you have virtual machine manager, why do you bother? No, I want to make it custom. How do you mean? I would like to run command which will deploy machine. I can tell which host, which name of the virtual machine, IP configuration, domain name, and that. I say, okay, can be done. No issues. So what I have done is that I have created something called deploy VM. It's a small script. So there is, just need to load the function. And so where it is, here it is. And you have something called deploy VM from template. So what it does? It takes the template, which is sysprep vhdx file, creates a differential disk, creates an unattended XML file, open VHD, puts XML file inside it, start it, and that's all. It works. It's relatively simple. So on the end, I have an example. So it's a demo tree. Let me just see if, no, I don't have a demo tree here. I just run it. You choose a template, you choose IP address of machine, default gateway, whatever. And if you open this one, it says demo tree. It works. It will build OS, it will automatically log on. And the customer says, great. One small change. Oh. Can you make a GUI? How do you mean a GUI? Yeah, it's nice, but I need to type and everything else. I would like to have a GUI from which I can run those commands. Anyone of you ever build a GUI in PowerShell? Is it easy? Yes, it is. PowerShell is easy, right? Every one of you needs to go out with this mantra, PowerShell is easy, okay? And we are just starting. So I say, okay, I need to build a GUI, okay? Then I did something like this. So, ladies and gentlemen, a GUI. You see this? Is this exe file? No, it's PS1. And you, what is this? This is actually a data set. This is a full-fledged data set, people. This one. Let me show you. So what I do here, I'm going to say home, HRE, this is my machine. I would say group name, ticket. This is nothing else than when I build machines, because how do you name a domain controller in the lab? DC01 or DC1. So this is just the, I have a couple of labs, it's just the group name. So it's ticket minus DC01, okay? So VM name, it's VM01, and template, it's 2012, okay? And I have one more. It's ticket, VM02, same template. Oh, let's put it R2, okay? And what I can do, say, I can say which VM switch. Now, if they are different Hyper-V hosts, they are different VM switches, right? So you have a small button which you click. It knows which VM switch is there. It connects to that. It knows which Hyper-V host you are, because you are selecting the first row. It knows it's, in this case, home HV04, and it gets all the switches from that host. So right now, when you go drop down, you see all the switches from that host. And let's say the memory is 248, two processors, 10111, 255, 255, 255, 10111, 10. And next one, because it's the same, I don't need to scale, and this is 10222, 10210, no, 255, 255, 255, 0, 10, 2, 2, 10. Okay? So this is it. And I added a little bit even more. And you see how, because when I go up and down, the IP address actually changes, because it's a data set, right? And I have export and import, because when you build a lab, you don't want to type it every single time, so you have export. So you can go like this, export, and say ticket, you do a clear, and you can do import. Ta-da! And you have this big button called build, okay? You hit that button, build, and it goes. It will build those machines. So this is phase one. In next phase, we are going to, you will be able to copy your production environment and to build a fully fledged test environment using this one. You just connect to your production environment, hit the button, and it will generate the test environment for you. And it's, we are not far away from it, really. So is PowerShell really hard to build a GUI? Now, if you try to do it by hand, it's not going to be very well. You need an editor. Let me show you one. It's not cheap, but it's good. If I can remember the password. Yeah, it's not a password, that's the problem. What I use, oh boy. So I hope I have D drive here or I'm in trouble. Oh yes, please work. It's called PowerShell Studio. And let me tell you how hard it is to build a GUI. So this is editor, but if you go to designer, you just go with your mouse. You design a GUI with a mouse. And when you double click on any of the buttons, it will automatically connect. It will automatically create a function. So that function is executed every time you hit the button. Trust me, this demo is about 1,000 something lines of code. Do you know how many of those are mine? Less than 50. So anyone saying that it's hard? Mouse, you just drag and drop on the left-hand side. Let me tell you. You go like this. Where is the button? Somewhere else. I have a button. Okay, button. I'm saying this. When I double click, it creates a function for me. Man, that's easy. So this is one of the demo. This is one of the features that I did. I also did updating Active Directory from CSV file. Basically, you have CSV file. You define which field in CSV file goes to which field in Active Directory. And we actually did that for one of the customers. And we are actually generating dynamically controls. That one is even better. Because it's fully generic application. So if you add five columns, it will generate five columns automatically. And you have a drop-down list. It says this column goes to this field in AD. And that's a couple hundred lines of code. So trust me, PowerShell knows GUI. You like this one? I mean, we're going too fast. It's going to be a short session. Fun, but short. Two more demos to do. Now, how PowerShell can save you money? That one is hard, right? We usually spend the money, but we need to save it. Now, this is recorded, right? So I might get into the trouble. When my wife comes from the shopping, she usually says, do you know how much I saved? Now I have a calculation to know how much she spent based on how much she saved. But she has a job, so I don't bother. And then, when I was actually showing this demo to one of my friends who is, I mean, ex-Excel Microsoft developer. And I'm talking about cutting edge stuff. He says, man, this is so 90s. I said, what? This, it's a data set. This is 90s. I mean, you're, any developers here? No? Data set, it's forgotten in 2000. No more data sets. What do you mean? He says, man, use a Wikipedia, go web services. This is what we do. Okay, web services. So I was thinking, okay, how can I, because my wife was saving money, so I decided I would like to save the money too. I like Lego, okay? And I live in a country in which the price of Lego is based on a very specific formula. they import the set, multiply price by 2, and convert to local currency. Really? So we usually joke about this business saying, I buy something for a cent, sell it for 2, and from that 1% commission I live. Now, when you do a math, it's not 1%, it's 100%, but it's a small stuff. Yeah, but at least I'm in a better position than you. Do you know how many Amazons are in Europe? 5. There are 5 Amazons in Europe. UK, France, Spain, Italy, Germany. Okay? Do you know how many different prices you have for same Lego set there? 5. Okay. So let me show you what I mean. This is, but now, if I, at the start, I was searching, I opened one Amazon and searching, and I was setting the different stuff, but then I figured out, man, this site is good. It's called brickset.com, okay? Anything you need to know about Lego bricks, you'll find it here. And one of the pages is really nice because it will tell you what is the price, what is retail price, what is price in UK, France, Germany, Spain, Italy. Okay? But you know what? It takes a time to read that every day. And you, sometimes the price is only there for a day. How hard would it be to build the PowerShell script that will do it for you? Web services, people, web services. 2013, web services, REST methods, right? So I was thinking, okay, there is applications. There are applications that can read this information. So I a little bit check the site, and I figure it out. It offers web services. So you can basically, for example, let's list the team. Let me just make it a little bit bigger. List team, and you have, if you are a developer, in plain text, saying what you need to do. I was partially a developer some time ago, so. But then I called my friends, okay, I read about web services. Now, help me with this. Says, you need to create everything else. Now, how many lines of code do I need in PowerShell do I need to read the web service? 1. What is the command? Invoke REST method. Invoke, I believe it's REST method, yeah. So let me tell you, it should be somewhere here. Ticket, demo 4, let's edit it. So it's called invoke REST method. Now we have 2 commands that you can read the web. One is invoke web request, another one is invoke REST method. The difference is that if you have web service, invoke REST method, it will return you array of object, but it will depend if it is XML, Atom, or whatever. Let me just show you how it does. In 2 lines, what I'm doing. I have a, because I'm searching for a year and for the set called Technics, right? So I have a Technics 2013, Technics 2012, and this is why I need double lines. So when I do this, and let me just paste it to the PowerShell. I hope the internet is working. Demo gods are good with me today. Let me just exit here. Yep, come on, die. Doesn't matter. So, ta-da! array of objects in two lines of code directly from web service. Beat that. Do you know anything? I mean, if you try that in any other language, it will be pure fun. Now, it really depends what you mean by fun. So I have a list of Lego sets, and those are techniques. Those are this one, 2,000 parts, really expensive. So if I can find there is discount for 20-25%, this costs 200 euros. If I find 40-30% discount, makes that I'm saving the money. A lot of money. So I have something called get. Give me some, need to go this way. Demo 4. It will take a little bit, okay? Get Lego price 2 sets. Let me just put this into the template, into temp file. And I'm going to tell you another story. You see, it's called get Lego price 2. The first version was complete disaster. Almost complete disaster. So what I was doing, I was actually searching the Amazon. It's relatively easy. You invoke web requests, search the data, and get the data back, whatever. But I, as a good husband, I ask my wife to test it. Okay, I say, give me one word that you want to search 5 Amazons in Europe. Now, girls. Let's try to see. Shoes? No? No. Again?
Diamond!
Yes! I was thinking, boy, this is not end up well. The good thing is that script failed. So I'm going to fix it. I'm going to call you a little bit later. Right now I have, I'll get Lego price too. It's search only Lego, so if she wants to buy a Lego, it's there. So let me show you what is in this file. It's array. This is the name of the set. First one, ID, discount. You see, 30% discount, right? I like it. List price, minimum price. What is the minimum price for that Lego set on that Amazon? What is location and current price? So what I do, I can search it, for example, where discount greater than 25. So what I see here is that, where it is? No, it's gone. It was, one of the set was on the, you see what is the problem? When I was testing it yesterday, it was there. So what I see that is that, for example, excavator is here, 42, right now is 33, okay, 31. Man, you're saving money. And I am PFE. I have PFE all over Europe. So I'm just ordering to their country. But sometime, because my wife actually doesn't know that I'm doing it, but I'm here, I'm in Australia, and the guy from France was visiting Serbia, and he says, okay, I bring you part of your boxes. I said, oh, I'm not here, but you can call my wife. Oh boy, that was a mistake. My wife sent me an SMS saying, your friend was here, he bring 3 boxes. You're not normal. 3 sets? I said, are there big boxes or small boxes? She said, small boxes. Okay, the bigger one in Paris, okay. And they are. The big boxes are in Paris. So, almost there. Now, my friend actually from Sydney called me to do this presentation here. And he says, okay, it will be perfect. You come come to Sydney, you will be 1 week at my place. I will show you the Sydney. Do you know what I saw in Sydney? Manly, DUI, Kerr, freshwater.
Bondi.
Okay? He likes to surf. This is what I saw in Sydney. Beaches. I'm posting the pictures and so. And couple of months ago, I was having conversation with him, and I asked him what you did. I don't know. I went to customer that and there, but man, that was pain. I said, why? I was driving near the shore, and the swell was perfect. Okay, what is the swell? Then he explained. He says, forget about these Lego prices, whatever. You need to find a way how to script me, so you can send, you create my instance and send it to customer, so I can go swimming.
Surfing.
So I was thinking, how hard would it be to automate a person? What we need? We need a robot, right? So, do you know what is the name of that Honda robot? Yeah. Asimo, right? I said, perfect. This one I believe they are doing they're actually trying to use that robot to be a guide in the museum. I believe it completely failed on the first day, but I assume that they figured it out. So I called them and say, I would like to have one. I said, cool, 2 million. I called my manager, he says, do you have a business case? I said, yeah, I'm going to Gold Coast to present the PowerShell, I would like to have, no, declined. But you know what I have a lot in my room? I have Lego. And I was thinking, man, I have one robot there. But before that, let me show you, that robot needs to have a brain, right? Do you know what is this? It's called Lego Mindstorms, okay? This is called Intelligent Brick. This is actually it's a toy, but you'll find those on any course on robotics, on any college or whatever, they're teaching this on the first year. So what you have four sensors. Those are here. One will fall off because... So you have a sound sensor. You can scream to it if you want. You have... this is ultrasound, like on your car. This is a light and a color sensor. And this is a button. And this one, on the other side, you have connection for three-step motors. So you can actually control... amount of force, and you can control the how many degrees of this thing turn. Okay, how hard would it be to read all those stuff from PowerShell?
Easy.
Right? Yeah. So let me try. 7. Okay, turn it on, ta-na-na-na, and this is okay. So what I have here, I have something called connect, I have a battery level, there is a 6 1.5 volt batteries there, okay, this is why it's 9. I have press button, I have distance, I have a sound. I'm going to scroll a little bit. Let me just move the mouse. I have a color and I have a motor. So let's see what will happen. The color sensor is it's going to fall off probably in this demo. So watch the distance. So this is my hand, okay? One, two, three. See the sound? I can use a color, but whatever. So, but this is, we need to have, I'm going to press this button, which one? And this motor will turn. So what will happen is that this script, which runs, it will detect that I press the button and it will turn the motor. And it will turn the motor as long as I'm pressing the button. So I have a brain, right? I can move and I can detect. I only need a robot. And boy, I have one. Now, it's one of the most famous robot ever. Do a guess.
Danger, little robots are dangerous.
This one is good one. Come on. Ladies and gentlemen. So inside, there is exactly the same intelligent brick. You can take the head off, okay? This is actually the brick inside. And this is a demo, so it only has one motor. The only problem, it's not going to run very well on this carpet, but this will tell you, front row, it's best seats in the house. Now, there is one feature that I'm currently not very good at it, a start button. So let me tell you what you need to do. It's a little bit hidden. Under construction. You get it. So let's see. Will it run? This resolution is killing me a little bit. Yeah. So let's hope. It moves! It's alive! Do you want to see it again? One more time. He likes you. When I show this to my colleague in Microsoft, which is also PFE, he says, boy, this is, you're going to be left out of job. How do you mean? He says, this is a PFE 2.0. Do you know what PFE is? Anyone having Premier support contract? Yeah. Anyway, we come and we hold the workshops and risk assessment programs. Man, this, the Premier in 5 years, he will just send those things to the customer. Now, because we fly a lot, we stay in hotel. They can FedEx it. No need to travel. He can sleep at the customer site. He can even recharge during the night. Exactly. So I'm going to be out of job, right? Now, the big question, can I make him talk? Man, I'm out of job, definitely. I started with business case. I will end up with one. R2D2, 150 euros. Lego Mindstorms, 250, 400 euros. The business case for me to be here at TechEd in Gold Coast, priceless. Ladies and gentlemen, it was my pleasure. Please fill up the evals, and if you want to see how it works, come here and we can talk.